Please stand for the call to worship. Sing to Yahweh a new song, for he has done wonderful things. His right hand and his holy arm have gained the victory for him. The Lord has made known his salvation, and he has revealed his righteousness in the sight of the nations. He's remembered his covenantal promises and his faithfulness to his people. All the ends of the earth have seen the salvation of our God. So shout joyfully to the Lord, all the earth, and break forth and sing for joy and sing praises. Let the sea roar, all it contains, the world, those who dwell in it. Let the rivers clap their hands. Let mountains sing together for joy before the Lord, because he is coming to rule the earth. He will judge the world with righteousness and govern his peoples with equity. Beloved, let's invoke God's name together. Blessed be the Lord God of Israel, for he has visited and redeemed his people and has raised up a horn of salvation for us in the house of his servant David, as he spoke by the mouth of the holy prophets from of old. Hear your king's greeting. To those who have been sanctified in Christ Jesus, saints by calling, with all who in every place call upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ in the power and fellowship of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We make our Trinitarian profession, and you see how it is divided up between Father, Son, and Spirit, and how the Son is divided between Jesus the person, the God, and the man. And of course, for us and for our salvation, that incarnational declaration that we make. And lastly, the ministry of the Holy Spirit in the church. So let us profess this summary of the Christian faith and our Trinitarian doctrine together. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. And in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, begotten of the Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried. And the third day he rose again, according to the scriptures, and ascended into heaven and sits on the right hand of the Father, and he shall come again with glory to judge the living and the dead, whose kingdom shall have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Well, let us continue then by singing, O Come All Ye Faithful, this joyous declaration that we are indeed a people who are blessed by God, able to worship the Lord Jesus Christ, who came as our Redeemer. Let us sing.
Oh, come,
Please be seated. We affirm it is right and good to sing joyfully of a triumph that has occurred, and that is God has become flesh, dwelt among us, and redeemed us. But why? Why do we need a redeemer? Let us together remind ourselves of the use and purpose of the law and how it reveals our sinful condition and of the necessity of a redeemer if we are to have peace with God. Let us turn then to the reading of the law and read the introduction together. The word of God is a lamp to our feet and a light to our path. In his word, he tells us what is good and what he requires of us: to do justice, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God. But instead, we ignore the clear commands and perform acts not required by God: ceremonies, fastings, prayer vigils, making unnecessary vows, which have only the appearance of wisdom. But we will not humble ourselves, give up our sins, and obey the plain commands of God. All of us have sinned, and the wages of our sin is death. We try to bring the law to you from different passages in order that we just not go through a repetition and you kind of blank out, but rather to consider, what is God actually saying and what is required of me? And one of the great dangers that we run into is the moralistic trap that actually the outsiders accuse us of. Oh, you guys just think you're good because you don't steal and you don't curse and all that. Well, here, look at what God says he wants from us. Remember, if he commands it, that makes it law. Look at these passages, starting at Psalm 50. Make thanksgiving your sacrifice to God, and perform your vows to the Most High, and call upon me in the day of trouble. I will deliver you, and you will glorify me. And the one who offers thanksgiving as a sacrifice glorifies me. And to the one who orders his way rightly, I will show the salvation of God. Psalm 95. Oh, come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us make a joyful noise to the rock of our salvation. Let us come into his presence with thanksgiving. Let us make a joyful noise to him with songs of praise. Psalm 100. Enter his gates with thanksgiving. Enter his courts with praise. Give thanks to him. Bless his name. For Yahweh is good. His covenantal love endures forever, and his faithfulness is to all generations. Psalm 118. This is the day the Lord has appointed. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Philippians 4. Let your reasonableness be known to everyone. The Lord is at hand. So you, do not be anxious about anything. Instead, in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. Colossians 2. Therefore, as you receive Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk in him, rooted, built up, established in the faith, just as you were taught, abounding in thanksgiving. And to the Thessalonians, he writes, rejoice always, pray without ceasing, and give thanks in all circumstances, because this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. What these law passages do is forces us to consider God is not impressed with our moralism, our law keeping, because quite frankly, no one keeps the law. We're already told there's no one who does good, not even one. So we are a people who are redeemed by grace, and he commands, recognize, let that be known to others that you have joy in your heart and thanksgiving expressed with your song and with your prayers and with your praises of me. Why? Because you are making a declaration. I am a good and loving God and Father to you, and I've sent you a Redeemer. Christians who are constantly tense and angry that others are sinning, they've completely missed the important point. They've been delivered. And so the law of God says, consider and live actively as a rescued, redeemed person with thanksgiving in your heart. That glorifies me. Because the world knows there's something so much better for them than the pursuits of this age. I know it's hard to consider be thankful is law, but that's really, every command is law. And God says, this glorifies me. Because you are testifying there's more to this world than just what anybody is having immediate stress about. And looking back at Philippians, so don't be anxious about anything. Rather, knowing that I am a personal, loving Father to you, with thanksgiving, let your prayers be made known to me. I will deliver you because you've called upon me in the day of your trouble. And because I'm your deliverer, you will glorify me. So give thanks in all circumstances. Now, worded this way, that seems to be a little bit more burdensome, but it really isn't, because we have a gracious God. But we need to be aware of how much we need him. So first question, having now heard this, can you keep this law perfectly? How do you answer? No, for I'm inclined by nature to hate God and my neighbor. And if you're not a law keeper, how can you have any hope? Beloved, what is your only comfort in life and in death? That I am not my own, but belong body and soul, in life and in death, to my faithful Savior, Jesus Christ. He has fully paid for all my sins with his precious blood, and has delivered me from the tyranny of the devil. He also watches over me in such a way that not a hair can fall from my head without the will of my Father in heaven. In fact, all things must work together for my salvation. Because I belong to him, Christ, by his Holy Spirit, also assures me of eternal life and makes me wholeheartedly willing and ready from now on to live for him. Well, let us be prepared daily, not only to confess our particular sins, but also to ask God that he would indeed work in our hearts sincere thankfulness and gratitude, as well as assurance and comfort, because we know he is a faithful Savior. Let us confess to God our inadequacies, our sins, and also ask him to help us grow in sanctification, that we would more and more be conformed to the image of Christ our Lord. We come to you, our Lord and our God, having to deal with this revelation that we are indeed a people who have really never fully believed and appreciated what it means to be delivered from death to life. And so we worry, we're anxious. We don't really expect, when we call on you, that you would deliver us, even though that is exactly what you've done, more so before we called on you. While we were dead in our sins, Christ died for our redemption. We pray now that you will work in our hearts true thankfulness that will be revealed with joyful worship, as well as joyful life. Because whatever else happens in this world, we know we are fading and passing away, but our lives are hid now with Christ Jesus. May we therefore be truly grateful. And as others today even speak of your coming, let us be those who are most willing to express and explain and tell others why this was so necessary, so very good, and how it reveals the great love of God. We ask, O Lord, that indeed we would be thankful, filled with joy, and also, like young children, absolutely confident when we call upon you, you will deliver us. May we therefore always call upon you, asking not only for forgiveness and restoration, but also for the sanctifying work of the Spirit, that indeed we would reflect the image of Christ more and more until the day that we are finally glorified and dwell with you forever. Amen. Well, beloved, let's have your joy be complete. Stand to hear the absolution. Well, beloved, to you who by faith have confessed and repented of your sins and have trusted in Jesus' merit alone, I declare in the name of Christ and by the authority of his word, your sins are forgiven, and the record of your transgressions is blotted away, and your everlasting salvation is hid now in Christ, who will resurrect you in the last day. And so, knowing that we are called to a godly life, I will ask this next question. We are saying that despite our failures, we have been delivered by grace alone through faith alone. So why, if you are indeed redeemed from your misery by grace through Christ without works of the law, without merit, why then does the church, following the scriptures, insist that you pursue good works? Let's respond. Because Christ, having redeemed us by his blood, also renews us by his Holy Spirit after his own image, that with our whole life we show ourselves thankful to God for his blessing, and that he be glorified through us. Then also that we ourselves may be assured of our faith by the fruits thereof, and by our godly walk win also others to Christ. Well, beloved, let us respond to this great news of the gospel that Jesus has come reconciling sinners to God through his flesh, his sacrifice, and finally now his mediation. Hark the herald angels sing. Please be seated. As we turn this morning to the matters for prayer on page 16, we understand that we are indeed commanded to join with those angels and to declare to the world, come and see him who was born a savior for you this day. And so throughout the year, we have prayed alphabetically for all the nations, and we've asked you to do that at home also. But now we've come to the end of the alphabet, and so now we cover the continents, and actually for the 31st, it just says the world on the prayer guide. And of course, we will continue these prayers year after year because that must be the desire of the church. We add to these prayers also thankfulness that we will express to God today, because at the Ventura church that we oversee, they are receiving three new members, two by profession and one by baptism. And so we rejoice with them in this. And also we continue to lift up our brother Raymond, who has been separated from us for so long. We ask that God would give him mental clarity, and that he could be restored to us soon. So let us pray. Our great God, what a wondrous day where we are able to behold your creation, where we are able to once again wake up to a new day and see that you have continued to govern heaven and earth by your mighty hand, and all things continue to work together for good. One day in seven, drawing your people to yourself. And Lord, it is indeed a wonderful thing, whatever other trials and tribulations, that throughout the world this day you've gathered for yourself a people from every tribe and tongue and nation to be one in Christ. And we are privileged to be able to bear the name of Christ and be part of this body. May we therefore truly be thankful, because this testifies to our eternal inheritance and everlasting life. Whatever other troubles we have are all fleeting away. But this inheritance is founded on your sure word. May we therefore glory in you and be thankful that we are indeed even now able to hear the mind of God revealed through the preached word, and also that we are able to respond with thankfulness, singing songs of joy, singing of your incarnation, of the deliverance which is ours through the awesome ministry of Christ, the Son of God. We come to you today thankful not only for this church and this assembly of believers, but for all faithful and true churches around the world. We ask, O Lord, that you will preserve your church and you will cause those that are struggling or wavering to once again be firm in their conviction and preach the pure word of the gospel, which alone is able to save sinners, and for the church to remain salt and light and to bring the hope of life to those who are perishing. We pray for the work in Ventura. We are so thankful, Lord, that you have chosen to grow this small work. May that work be fruitful and a blessing and be with the new members, and let there be joy in the hearts of the believers as they see you continuing to call out of darkness, call out of spiritual Babylon those who are being rescued. And may they be joined with those who are ascending heavenly Zion and obtain all the blessings of life. Lord, we pray for the work in Armenia, and we pray that Reformed Faith and Life would have an effective witness and ministry. Lord, we know at this time they are seeking to care for refugees, and it is indeed a difficult time. And while the world does not seem to want to talk about it, Lord, we see that this is the fruit of the persecution of the seeds of the serpent against the children of God. We pray that those who are suffering so much in this earthly way would not hold in contempt your providence, but indeed would consider that the hatred of their neighbors is not because of them personally, but because the neighbors see in them even a small part of the gospel. Lord, we ask that the Armenian believers would be able to minister to one another and encourage one another. We thank you for our privilege that we've been given to support this work, but we know it is not enough. We ask, O God, that you would cause the believers to not only have more confidence in your providence, even in the times of trial, but they would remember your call to not desire revenge, but to turn revenge over to you, but for now to pray for their enemies. And may Armenia be a blessing even to their worst enemies in that territory. And may the gospel go forth and those who were sons of darkness be made into children of light. Lord, we pray this day for Zimbabwe, knowing that there has been great turmoil and tribulation in this land, and there is much hatred among many peoples, and the church is corrupted. But Lord, there is still a small remnant of a faithful congregation. We ask that you would strengthen the believers to proclaim the truth, to call sin sin, but also to offer the hope of life through Christ, and that in Zimbabwe, the gospel would bring the hope of life even to those who are perishing from horrible diseases. But may they have an inheritance that is in heaven above and therefore find joy. And not only Zimbabwe, but all of Africa. Lord, we are thankful that in the last two centuries especially, you've allowed the gospel to go not just in North Africa, but throughout the entirety of Africa. And Lord, we rejoice that you've called for yourself people from many tribes and tongues and nations. But Lord, we also know today that Islam is again making inroads. May that cursed religion be turned back, and may the church, not with the sword, but with the preaching of the word, bring the hope of life to those who have been caught up in darkness and lies for generations. And may you, O Lord, be proclaimed throughout Africa as Lord and King. We pray for North and South America, thankful for great blessings and freedoms enjoyed, but also we come before you even more humbled by the absolute display of the foolishness of men. The more material blessings we have, the more we are free to worship, the more people turn away from you in corruption and blaspheme your name. Lord, we know we should expect no good thing when we curse him who is able to save, but we pray, do not allow us to perish in our foolishness or our neighbors. Lord, grant once again that the gospel would go forth in the U.S., but in North and South America and all the nations, that all these many churches who are called by your name would actually now desire to know you and proclaim your name aright. And may your gospel go forth and turn the hearts of men back to you. And may they be once again worshiping you in spirit and in truth. We pray for Asia, where so much of the world's population dwells, and yet so many are in darkness. Lord, may it be that the Christians who are found and dispersed throughout so many different groups would now become an effective witness. As you said, we are salt and light, and we bring the hope of life. May the believers of these lands speak to the local populations, whether they are shamanists, Buddhists, Hindus, Muslims, or simply those who don't care. Lord, may the gospel bring the hope of life, and may we see this most populous area of the planet be filled with those who are rejoicing at the deliverance that they have received, and may they pass this great news on to their children and to the nations all around. We pray for Europe, where we grieve as we see they have rejected a great inheritance that they had, and now the churches have become museums. Lord, what a shame that people have taken for granted your blessings and have forsaken Christ. Now we pray not because they deserve, but because you have been so gracious and because their fathers have done so much. Lord, restore the European peoples back to you, and may they not only believe, but also that they would be a blessing, and many immigrants who are in these lands would also hear the truth. And may churches once again be filled who are thankful for a deliverance and everlasting life. And so may you be glorified. And Lord, we pray for all the Pacific Rim and the Pacific Islands, that the gospel be proclaimed and be proclaimed clearly and be effective and fruitful. What a wondrous time for us to live, where we are able to see the manifestation of your work through Christ and by the work of the Spirit. What an amazing thing to consider that at the time of Christ walking the earth, there was a small spot where the light of the gospel shone, and now it is all around the world in so many languages. Lord, may we see even more, and may even we who have obtained this benefit not grow accustomed to it, but marvel at wow, how wonderful it is to receive grace. And may we continue to mature in the faith, and as we heard from the law, be thankful and filled with joy, and be prepared to call on you, knowing you, our loving Father, will deliver us. We thank you, Lord, for the works that we are part of and also our federation, and we ask that you be with the work in Jersey City, and we are thankful that that congregation continues to be fruitful and grow. And now we come to you, a people united by faith through Christ our Lord, your Son, and we can now call you Father in prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Well, beloved, I call upon you now to please stand to hear the written word. As we commemorate, we remember that Christ has come in the flesh, the Son of God made man. Let us look at how very real that flesh is as we see the fallen state of humanity from whom he has descended. From the Old Testament, Genesis chapter 38, starting at verse 13. And when Tamar was told, "Your father-in-law is going up to Timnah to shear the sheep," she took off her widow's garments and covered herself with a veil, wrapping herself up, and sat at the entrance of Enaim, which is on the road to Timnah. For she saw that Shelah was grown up, and she had not been given to him in marriage. When Judah saw her, he thought she was a prostitute, for she had covered her face. He turned to her at the roadside and said, "Let me come in to you," for he did not know that she was his daughter-in-law. She said, "What will you give me that you may come in to me?" Verse 24, about 3 months later, Judah was told, "Tamar, your daughter-in-law has been immoral. Moreover, she is pregnant by immorality." Joshua 2:1. Joshua, the son of Nun, sent two men secretly to Shechem as spies, saying, "Go view the land, especially Jericho." And they went, and they came into the house of a prostitute whose name was Rahab and lodged there. Ruth chapter 3. Then Naomi, her mother-in-law, said to her, "My daughter, should I not seek rest for you, that it may be well with you? Is not Boaz our relative with those young women you were, whose young women you were? See, he is winnowing barley tonight in the threshing floor. Wash, therefore, and anoint yourself, and put on your cloak, and go down to the threshing floor, but do not make yourself known to the man, until he has finished eating and drinking. But when he lies down, observe the place where he lies and go and uncover his feet and lie down, and he will tell you what to do." And she replied, "All that you say, I will do." So she went down to the threshing floor and did just as his mother-in-law had commanded. And when Boaz had eaten and drunk, and his heart was merry, he went to lie down at the end of a heap of grain, and she came softly and uncovered his feet and lay down. At midnight, the man was startled and turned over, and behold, a woman lay at his feet. 2 Samuel 11. In the spring of the year, the time when kings go out to battle, David sent Joab and his servants with him and all Israel, and they ravaged the Ammonites and besieged Rabbah, but David remained in Jerusalem. It happened late one afternoon when David arose from his couch and was walking on the roof of the king's house that he saw from the roof of a woman bathing, and the woman was beautiful. And David sent and inquired about the woman, and one said, "Is not this Bathsheba, the daughter of Eliam, the wife of Uriah the Hittite?" So David sent messengers and took her, and she came to him, and he lay with her. Now she had been purifying herself from her uncleanness. Then she returned to her house, and the woman conceived. And she sent and told David, "I am pregnant." Turn to the New Testament, starting in Matthew 1. The book of the genealogy, or the generations of Jesus Christ, the son of David, the son of Abraham. Abraham was the father of Isaac. Isaac was the father of Jacob. Jacob was the father of Judah and his brothers. And Judah, the father of Perez and Zerah by Tamar. And Salmon, the father of Boaz by Rahab. And Boaz, the father of Obed by Ruth. And Obed, the father of Jesse. And Jesse, the father of David the king. And David was the father of Solomon by the wife of Uriah. Verse 11. At the time of the deportation to Babylon. Verse 12. After the deportation to Babylon. Verse 17. So all the generations from Abraham to David were 14 generations. And from David to the deportation to Babylon, 14 generations. And from the deportation to Babylon to Christ, 14 generations. Now the birth of Jesus Christ took place in this way. When his mother Mary had been betrothed to Joseph, before they came together, she was found to be with child from the Holy Spirit. And her husband Joseph, being a just man and unwilling to put her to shame, resolved to divorce her quietly. But as he considered these things, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, "Joseph, son of David, do not fear to take Mary as your wife, for that which is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus. For he will save his people from their sins." All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had spoken by the prophet. "Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel," which means God with us. When Joseph woke from sleep, he did as the angel of the Lord commanded him. He took his wife, but knew her not until she had given birth to a son, and he called his name Jesus. Hebrews 2, 10 through 12. For it was fitting that he, for whom and by whom all things exist, in bringing many sons to glory, should make the founder of their salvation perfect through suffering. For he who sanctifies and those who are sanctified all have one source. That is why he is not ashamed to call them brother, saying, "I will tell of your name to my brothers. In the midst of the congregation, I will sing your praise." And Hebrews 11, 13 through 16. These all died in faith, every name we just read, with all their sins, not having received the things promised, but having seen them and greeted them from afar, and having acknowledged that they were strangers and exiles on the earth. For people who speak thus make it clear that they are seeking a homeland. For if they had been thinking of the land from which they had gone out, they would have had opportunity to return. But as it is, they desire a better country, that is, a heavenly one. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared for them a city. So far, the written word. We come to you, our Lord and our God. Lord, we are humbled by the knowledge of the type of men and women that we can be. And we know that the call to holiness is not idle words, and yet we must confess our sins before you each and every week. Now we ask, O God, that we should hear in the gospel proclaimed, the hope of life, and rejoice in Christ our Savior, the perfect and the only Redeemer of men, May we be thankful for these great blessings which you have worked for us, and may we sing the new song declaring your salvation. Amen. Please be seated. Well, many times in the Christian church, we fall into the trap of thinking we're kind of like, you know, we're privileged to be here, so we need to be better than others. As if our continuing to be better is the qualification for us remaining in Christ's church. And while indeed we are called to grow in holiness and in sanctification, to meditate upon the law, to love the law, and to be conformed more and more to the image of Christ, that's not why you are here. You are here because you were rescued and delivered. And while to some degree we acknowledge that, it's really painful to acknowledge from what we have been delivered. And so what's really interesting is that when God chose by the Holy Spirit to inspire the prophets to record his will of redemption, it is not only not sugar-coated, it is indeed raw, revealing very, very horrible things. And yet God wants us to think and know these things. Why? Well, because we are, in our better moments, aware of just who we were, and indeed, even now, how far we are from the sanctified lives we should be leading. And if we only think about that, and we believe the lie that Christians are the better people, then we will doubt our salvation, and eventually we will want no part of the church, and then we will become embittered with the church because we know that nobody there is perfect, so we'll complain about them being the hypocrites because, you know, we were honest. We acknowledged we were sinners. We left. Well, utter foolishness. Rather, what we need to do is consider the methodology of God's scripture being written and then the content of that scripture. So first, we're going to start with Matthew chapter 1, verse 17, where he divides up from Abraham to David as 14 generations, David to Babylon as 14, and then Babylon to Christ 14. The reason I want us to look at this, we've spoken of it before, so, you know, 14 divided by 2, 7. So this is 6 sevens, and Jesus is the seventh seven. In other words, he's the Jubilee year, the forgiveness of sins. And we looked at that elsewhere. But here the point that I want to make is, in order to get to these 14 generations, he deliberately omitted names that are found for us in 1 Chronicles 9. So, in other words, as God is inspiring the apostles to record these things, he is aware that we are going to be reading the Old Testament as well, and he deliberately omits some names. Now, is this because God is a liar or that the scriptures are unreliable? No. Rather, again, we need to be aware that this is how Hebrews wrote. To them, this was completely legitimate because they were not trying to distort the truth by omission. Rather, God is able, under the Hebrew mindset of the time, to speak in this way, and they all understood. Go back to Matthew 1:1. It speaks of, this is the book or the records of the genealogy of Jesus Christ, the son of David, the son of Abraham. Jesus, you know, legally speaking on earth, is the son of Joseph and Mary. That's how we would use the word. But for the Hebrew, as they thought, son of David was just as legitimate, even though Jesus is 1,000 years removed from David. Why? Because in their use of the word, in their use of language, son of can mean I refer to my prominent relative. So as opposed to a legal, narrow technical definition, son of meaning I am immediately fathered by this person, in Hebrew it means I am descended from this prominent line. So Jesus is both son of David and son of Abraham, and elsewhere, of course, son of God. In no way are we being lied to if we understand the proper use of the words. So with the elimination of those four generations in Matthew 1:17, speaking of someone being the son of whoever, it was recognized these are just the prominent names we are naming. Now, why is this important? Because of who God included. If you were dropping names out of the list, if you wanted to you know, form this story of Jesus being the great jubilee, the 49th year when the Liberty Bell would be rung and all debts would be canceled and you would be restored to your original estate. You know, yeah, there are great prominent names you can put in there. And if you need to throw out a few, how about you get rid of the prostitutes or the time that David committed adultery? But those are not the ones we get rid of, is it? No, those are all preserved. In fact, none of the women who had great reputations are here. It's all the ones that had some sort of struggle or stain on their names that are brought into this genealogy. Why? Because we need to be aware. Jesus is from sinners. He is descended from a sinful line, for a sinful line. And when you are aware of your sinfulness, it's not like you're catching Jesus off guard and he's ashamed of you. Rather, God willed that it would be recorded for us. He is descended from a woman who was a prostitute, from a woman who posed as one, from a woman whose advice from her mother-in-law was pretty lousy about how to get a man, and then from a woman who was seduced by a wicked king. Why record this when you're going to be saying, I want to tell you about God in the flesh who is sinless? Why record such history? Because it is for such people that Jesus took on flesh, so that he would be a sacrifice for this kind of sinner. So when you and I are made aware of our sins, you should not then feel, oh, well, I'm estranged and alienated from the church because they're not going to want me if they know what kind of sinner I am. And God, just in this genealogy, is saying, you think you have any secrets from me that I don't know? No, I brought you in here. So see the kinds of mothers that are recorded for Jesus. The first story in Genesis is Tamar. Now, Tamar is actually virtuous in the story. She has married one of the sons of Judah who dies. Under the customs of the time, she would then be given to the next brother, because remember, you're not dealing at the time where there's factories and employment. Rather, this is a time in which you have tribes. And when she has left her father's house and now she's identified with a new family line, if her husband dies and she has no children, she has no connection and no one to speak for her. So under the law of God, the next man in line would have to give her a child so that she would be bound to the family and have the protection of the clan. But the second son also dies. So now Judah has a third son. It's like, this woman is bad luck. I'm not giving her another one of my sons. So when his third son comes of age, Judah has essentially forsaken this woman. So when she now poses as this harlot, while she's doing the wrong, she is not trusting God, we can see the desperate situation to which she has come. An otherwise honorable woman is willing to be seen in this way. Why? Because if she doesn't get an heir, she is an outcast. Nobody protects her. So she does this. Now we see the kind of man Judah is. He's just traveling along and he decides, oh, there's women of ill repute here. I think I'll go there. Well, obviously Judah is a foul person in this story. And then Judah foolishly gives a token that identifies him because he owes money, and she uses that because when Judah is told, hey, your daughter-in-law was immoral and she's pregnant, he says, oh, well, she should be put to death for immorality. And she says, oh, by the way, this is the guy that made me pregnant. And Judah realizes, that was me. And so he sees his own hypocrisy and he protects her. Now, what's important about this story is Jesus could have come from a different line. He could have come from Joseph's line. Joseph is, after all, a son of Jacob, just like Judah. Joseph, granted, he starts kind of arrogant and annoying, but remember at the end of his life, his brothers had sold him into slavery and left him for dead. And when Jacob was gone and the brothers were terrified he's going to take revenge, Joseph said, God willed good in all this that transpired. And yes, I was separated from my family and father for 20 years. I was left for dead. I mean, being sold into slavery is not like getting a lousy job contract. It meant ordinarily salt mines and things like that and death. But he says, I will not take revenge. In fact, I will care for you and your children. The very thing you were going to cut me off from, having descendants, I will use all my wealth to care for your families. That's the line I would want Jesus to come from, right? Not this guy who travels and goes to women of ill repute, but that's not the one. Again, notice whom God is revealing to us our Savior has come from, so that we would be assured he does indeed understand us. Joshua chapter 2, Rahab, Canaanite woman, not even a Jew, marries into the Jewish line, but starts life in a field of work that is not ideal. But she's recorded by name. The story of Ruth. Now, we like to think of her as more virtuous and honorable, and probably she was, but Naomi, her mother-in-law, not the best mother-in-law. She basically says, wait till the men have worked hard, gotten a little bit tipsy, and go seduce one. Now, a particular one, obviously, but this is not an honorable way to enter the godly line, and she's a Moabite woman on top of that. So again, you see a lot of improprieties. None of you would advise your daughters, oh, this is the way to get yourself a good man. We'd be horrified. And then 2 Samuel. This story, of course, so horrible that David, after being warned by his advisors, this is the wife of one of your 30 best warriors, your very good friend. And he says, yeah, but she's pretty. And I'm the king. Give her to me. Again, if you read the stories, if you remember the history of David, his friend Jonathan, the son of Saul, the king, Jonathan knew that if David lived, Saul's line and lineage would end and David would become king. That meant Jonathan knew he would not become king. He even recognized the only way that happens if there's already an established dynasty is I have to die. And all Jonathan did was love and protect David. Again, from whose line would you rather have a savior? Jonathan, who would give up all things for his friend, or David, who would take his friend's wife and have him murdered? Well, that's the one we have. So why all this now for us? Because God wants us to really be aware. I know who you are. And in fact, when I sent Christ, he is born of a virgin, but she is of the sinful Davidic line. And he comes into this fallen world descended from such peoples. He is not ashamed of you and me when we repent, when we recognize that we are being delivered from death to life, because he is God with us and he has been given, as it says in Matthew 1:21, to save his people from their sins. That's the wonder of this time. God in the flesh is not, again, some academic concept or some high idealistic thing. It is very much flesh and blood. Jesus is born in the flesh in a very foul list of people. And let's move beyond that even. You know, born in a manger, you know, in one of the carols, you know, in a cattle stall. Now, you and I living in the city, speaking of, you know, that there's no room for Jesus in the inn and they're, you know, they're sent off to the barn. Well, think about this now as in the ancient Near East. In other words, not like third world today, but third world with none of the benefits we have today of running water and better sanitation and all that. Jesus was born with animals, droppings, overwhelming stench, filth everywhere, humiliated that they could not afford or find one clean bed. And obviously, the weather's bad enough that they're not sleeping outside. They have to be inside with all this mess. Why? Because we have to understand the depth of the love of God. He wants you and me to be aware, I know who you are. I know how bad your condition is. I know what you need. And I will sacrifice everything. I will withhold nothing in order to deliver you. And when you are aware of how great is the work needed for your deliverance, that's why we have the passages from Hebrews. Be aware, I am not ashamed to call you my brothers. That's a remarkable testimony. Now, on the one hand, we can say, yeah, of course, look at who you're descended from. Why should you be proud? You think as many years as your family line has been in existence that you're here, you don't have these very same people in your lines? In fact, it's more likely that you and I are descended from bad people, because the good people tend to get killed. The more violent armies come in and kill off the men and take the women. So it is way more likely that our bloodlines are foul and corrupt by these very kinds of people. And Jesus says, I am not ashamed to call you my brothers, because I'm not going to identify you in your righteousness any longer, but I am going to be your righteousness. Jesus is the righteousness of God in the flesh, fulfilling all the commands of God with thankfulness, with joy, with a desire for the glory of God, and with love for you so much that he would do everything commanded for your deliverance. And even these people, they died in faith. Imperfect. They did not have the hope of life in their righteousness. In fact, God recorded all these things so that they could never be proud or brag. And yet they died confident they would dwell in the house of God forever. How? Because righteousness would be given to them. Because the greater son of David, the greater son of Abraham, would fulfill the requirements of the law and die the sinner's death. And so he was the perfect sacrifice for sins, and now he sanctifies us, not ashamed to be called our brother, and God is not ashamed to call us his children. That's the good news. And I mean, I'm happy that people are thinking about it, although disappointed that it's sentimental claptrap most of the time, but we don't need to fall into that trap. We can look at this and say, this is an incredible testimony and revelation being given. That God, being able to exclude names that are embarrassing, did not. God having a choice of more virtuous brothers or friends from which Christ could descend, did not do that. Instead, he gave us this line, and he recorded it for us to consider. And he wants us to know he is indeed our Savior. And in all this, remember, he wants you confident. I'm not ashamed of you. I'm not ashamed of the world knowing you are my children, my church, which is why he says you are the body of Christ, with Christ the head. So what does that mean for you and me? Well, as we consider that we are indeed sinners saved by grace, then we should never forget that. And when you fall into sin, remember, God knows this. That's why we have this process every week of saying, glad you're all here. We want you to worship, but understand, you know you don't deserve to be here. That's why we read the law. You don't have a natural worth. But you really are called to worship, and your worship will be received. Why? Because Christ cancels out the debt of your sins and gives you his righteousness, which is why now you are indeed salt and light in the world. Even if the world is too blind to see it, that's not from the lack of the Spirit working in you. It's the Spirit has not yet regenerated them. Hence why we know what a blessing we've received, and we want this blessing to go forth, so we pray for the nations and for the ministry of this church as well. So going back to our original sermon, the mothers of Jesus. Previously, I've also had a similar passages, but different title. Jesus of sinners and for sinners. Same idea. God wants you and me to know. He's saving sinners. He knows exactly what he's doing. And when you become aware of the full extent of your sinfulness. When you mature, or sometimes where something happens where it exposes just indeed how bad you could be and are, your reaction should not be, "Nah, I guess I don't belong here." Rather, it should be, God says he's not ashamed of me. And Jesus was willing to be identified with such people as me before. Well, he's not going to forsake me now. And so I can live confident that in Jesus, the God-man, Emmanuel, God with us, my jubilee has come. All my debt is canceled. And now is the day of restoration. Now is the day that I can remember my original estate and what shall be yet again. And so we continue in our worship service by going to the Lord's table, because now it's testifying of the great wedding feast, of the banquet when we, as the bride of Christ, will be called home and celebrate, though it's not yet time. So we only get a slight token for the moment, but it points us forward to the greater age which is to come. So, beloved, that is a wonderful thing, this day of remembering, commemorating the incarnation of Jesus Christ. Don't get caught up in the silly way of thinking about it. Consider the full weight of what it means. God loved you and me so much, John 3:16, to this depth, to this extent, in this way God loved the world. His only begotten Son, so precious to him, he sacrificed him for your deliverance. And for your confidence that he indeed knew what he was getting into, he was descended from this humiliating line. And then he even goes and rescues many from that very line itself. What a wonderful, wonderful gospel we have. Let's pray. Our Lord, our God, we hear much about you ascending on your throne, you ruling a kingdom, but over and over again, we keep doubting your power to save, and we keep on trying to impress you, not remembering that you are very mindful of our frame, and you see all our sins. We come before you today, and we ask that by your Spirit working in our hearts, we will indeed seek to wrestle with and understand your methodology in revelation, the content of the revelation, its significance for our Christian lives, and what it means and how it points forward to everlasting glory. And we pray that as we learn and understand these things better, that we would be able to articulate it, and we would be able to be used by you to be salt and light to our families, to our neighbors, as we know many people who are perishing, and as we consider the kinds of people with whom Christ has identified, including us, we are confident he can save even the worst people around us, but they still need to hear this gospel. Lord, grant that the preaching of the word would be powerful and effective from this day forward, as it has been for generations. We ask for it to be even more efficacious now, as this is the people we know and love. So we ask for the power of your word to bring salvation to many, to those who have come to know Emmanuel, Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. We will continue then by singing Joy to the World, that affirms the coming of Jesus Christ, the establishment of an eternal kingdom. This is Psalm 98, kind of made Christological, expressing what it means from our call to worship. So let us stand and sing Joy to the World, the Lord has come.
Prepare it.
Please be seated. Well, with the Lord's Supper, we are given a visual confirmation, a sealing sign testifying to a reality of an inheritance which is yet to come, the great banquet. But it is not for everyone, as those who would hear this word that is given to them and say, oh, that's sweet. And yeah, I mean, I'm glad people who are really bad can feel better about themselves, but you know, God will like me for who I am. Well, then this gospel is not for you. The gospel is for broken and polluted sinners whose only hope is to be found in Jesus Christ. And in the Lord's Supper, you are saying, I recognize the only way I can enter the presence of God is if somebody is put to death for my sins. If I'm put to death, I cannot enter in, so someone else must be. And the only one worthy is Christ Jesus. And as I come, then I am having to look at the Father and say, yes, your Son, his death is my only hope. And so I come washed with his blood, with his Spirit dwelling in me. So the Lord's Supper is indeed something that should bring great humility and contemplation, but also assure us that indeed God has given to us a Savior. And so again, we welcome all of you who are visiting today, but again, we ask that you consider our policies for participation. And if you're not sure as to how this works or why, it is in order that when you receive the supper, when you receive the elements, you are given the testimony of the church. This is for you. We know you, and we want you to be assured that indeed Christ is your all-sufficient Savior. We read in the scriptures that the Lord Jesus, in the night in which he was betrayed, took the bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Therefore, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of profaning the body and the blood of the Lord. Now, for all who live in rebellion against God and in unbelief, this holy food and drink will bring you only further condemnation. If you do not yet confess Jesus Christ and seek to live under his gracious reign, we ask you to abstain. Nevertheless, for those of you who've confessed your sins and who have affirmed your faith in Christ alone, the promise is sure. Whoever eats my body and drinks my blood has eternal life and will not come into condemnation. You are invited to this sacred meal, not because you're worthy in yourself, but because you are clothed in Christ's perfect righteousness. So do not allow the weakness of your faith or your failures in the Christian life to keep you from this table. For it is given to us because of our weakness and because of our failures, in order to increase our faith by feeding us with the body and blood of Jesus Christ. So as the word has promised us God's favor, so also our Heavenly Father has added this confirmation of his unchangeable promise. So come, believing sinners, the table is ready. Taste and see that the Lord is good. Let's pray. Almighty and everlasting God, who by the blood of your only begotten Son has secured for us a new and living way into the Holy of Holies, cleanse our minds and hearts by your word and spirit, that we, your redeemed people, who draw close to you through these holy mysteries, may enjoy fellowship with the Holy Trinity through the body and blood of Christ our Savior. Our ascended Savior does not live in temples made by hands, but he is in heaven, seated where he continues to intercede on our behalf. Through this mystery, by your own word and spirit, we affirm that these common elements are now set apart from ordinary use. While remaining ordinary bread and wine, these sacred elements nevertheless become so united to the reality they signify that we do not doubt but joyfully believe we will receive in this meal nothing less than the crucified body and shed blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. So now we come to the heavenly table to receive the gift of God for our souls. Amen. Beloved, that we may be nourished with Christ, who is the true bread from heaven, let us lift up our hearts to Christ Jesus, our advocate, who is at the right hand of his heavenly Father. And let us firmly believe every one of the promises, never doubting, that we will really be nourished and refreshed with his body and blood through the mysterious work of the Holy Spirit, as surely as we receive bread and wine in remembrance of him. So, beloved, lift up your spirits and hearts on high. We lift them up to the Lord. Elders, is there one available? Okay, so please come forward at this time to receive the elements. Truly, truly, I say to you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in yourself. But he who eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up on the last day. My flesh is true food, my blood is true drink. Jesus knew that the time had come for him to leave this world and go to the Father, and having loved his own who were in the world, he now showed them the full extent of his love. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, that he lays down his life for his friends. You are my friends, if you do what I command. No longer do I call you servants. Servants don't know what their master is doing, but I call you friends. For all that I have heard from my Father, I have made known to you. You did not choose me, I chose you, appointing you to go forth and bear fruit, and that your fruit should abide. Christ, our Passover lamb, has been sacrificed. He did not enter or offer himself again and again the way the high priest enters the most holy place every year with blood not his own. Rather, he has now appeared once for all at the end of the ages to do away with sin by the sacrifice of himself. Just as it is destined for man to die once, then the judgment, so Christ was sacrificed once to take away the sins of many people, and he will appear a second time, not to bear sin, but to bring salvation to those who are waiting for him. You have come to Mount Zion, the heavenly Jerusalem, the city of the living God, with the angels in joyful assembly, and you have come to God, the judge of all men, the Spirit of righteous men made perfect, and to Jesus, the mediator of the new covenant, whose sprinkled blood speaks a better word than the blood of Abel. One of the things that's difficult for us to imagine is just how great was the humiliation of Jesus, showing how deep was his love for us. And this is where, again, we have to get past the sentimentality and consider he's eternal God, and that means he is perfectly holy. He only loves righteousness. He hates sin. Did you see? Do you remember the type of the lineage from which he came? He loved you to that extent that his love made him to be born, not just of a sinful line, but of a foul line, because he wanted to be the sacrifice for your sins. And that meant going to the cross and facing the full wrath of the Father. So in partaking of the bread and the wine, you are saying, that's the depth of the love of God, and that's the horror of my sinfulness, that this cost had to be borne by my Savior. So Jesus took the bread and broke it, declaring, this is my body. I will suffer and die for you. This is my body broken for you. And you will be forgiven all of your sins. So, beloved, take, eat, remember, and believe the body of Christ your Savior broken for you, that he would cancel out the debt of your sins. Jesus also took the cup and declared, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. And by this ordaining of a new covenant, your guilt and sin will be taken away. So, beloved, take, drink, remember, believe the blood of Christ, which washes away your sins and makes you pure in the sight of God, that you will dwell in his house forevermore. Let's pray. Our gracious Heavenly Father, We acknowledge the great mystery of this holy feast, and although we are indeed unworthy to share this meal with you, we come by your invitation. You have robed us in Christ's righteousness, and now we enter boldly the Holy of Holies. Instead of wrath, we've received pardon. In the place of fear, we've been given hope. Our high priest and mediator of the new covenant has reconciled us to you, and even now is interceding for us actively at your right hand. So, dear Lord, please strengthen us by these gifts, so that, relying only on your promise to save sinners who call on your name, we may, by your Spirit, honor you with our souls and bodies, to the honor and glory of your holy name. Amen. Hearing this gospel, one, you need to believe and rejoice. As we said, be thankful and sing songs of joy to God because you've been delivered from death to life. Knowing that this is an incredible gift, we should also, knowing that God should be worshiped by all, pray that this gospel go forth and prayerfully give and support this work. And while we are looking at the cash offerings now, it also means give of your time, give of yourself, give of your pride. Be willing to speak to others, even if you're scared or a little bit ashamed. Do not be ashamed of these things. And also be willing to send the next generation. Let's be willing to give up our sons to go into the ministry and also to be missionaries going to the ends of the earth. So the offering, the material, is a testimony of something much greater that I hope you are giving, and that is yourself in commitment to the propagation of the gospel and a willingness to send even our descendants to the ends of the earth, even to the darkest lands, in order that the gospel may be proclaimed. Let us now stand and conclude by singing of the glory of God and desiring that his majesty be known and proclaimed in all the earth. These are the closing verses of Psalm 104. With the benediction, the Lord sends you with the knowledge that he is still with you and ministering to you. May the God of hope fill you with joy and peace in believing, so that by the power of the Holy Spirit, you may abound in hope. And may the God of endurance and encouragement grant us all to live in such harmony with one another, in accord with the will of Christ Jesus, that together we may with one voice glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.